الحمد لله رب العالمين، نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، إنه من يهده الله فهو المهتد، ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. ونصلي ونسلم على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبع هداه. All praises are due to Allah, the creator, the cherisher, and the sustainer of this universe. And may his peace and blessings be upon his noble prophet Muhammad and his descendants and companions and followers, dear respected two brothers and all the sisters. Thank you very much and Jazakum Allah Khairan for coming on time. Actually, I apologize that today I forgot the adapter that I used to operate my, hook the Apple laptop to the projector, and this cable is not equipped with an Apple adapter. So today, inshallah, we will work classically from the Quran. So every one of you should have a Quran, whether on the iPad or the iPhone or the Samsung, or a paper Quran, so that today I will tell you the number of the verse, go to the verse quickly, and we will be discussing it. This is the third session of our 8-week workshop, inshallah, about Surah Al-Kahf. And it's about Tadabbur Surah Al-Kahf. It's about reflection about Surah Al-Kahf. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent us the Quran in order to do Tadabbur for its verses. This is the main goal from sending the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, كتاب أنزلناه إليك مبارك ليتدبروا آياته. A blessed book that I have sent to you so that they may reflect upon its meanings. ليتدبروا. This lamb is called in Arabic lamb السببية. The lamb of cause, which means that what comes after it is the cause of what came before it. So Allah sent us this book to reflect upon its meanings. The problem is we use it differently. We use it to bring blessings and barakah to the house. So we put a big Quran in the reception of the house. When you open the door, you see a big Quran, and we believe that this is to bring blessings to the house. And still, this is not why Allah sent us the Quran. We put it on the dashboard of the car so that the car don't get stolen, and still the cars get stolen. Even though there's a Quran in the dashboard. But that's not why Allah sent the Quran. We frame it in frames and put it on the walls. That's not why Allah sent the Quran. Allah sent this Quran to read it, understand it, reflect upon its meanings, and use it as a guide. Use it as a constitution, a law for our life, instructions that come from Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent us his final messenger, final prophet, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whom among his commands to us is to read and reflect upon Surah Al-Kahf. One of the 114 surahs was chosen by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we were told that we should read it every Jum'ah, which means like every week we should read it. In my own opinion, this is not for the barakah, because all the Quran is barakah. Had it been for the barakah, the Prophet could have told us choose one surah to read every week. But since he specified one, he chose one in particular, this means that this surah has meanings and has lessons and has an impact on the Muslim, and it should be renewed every week in our life. We said also that this surah is the surah of reform. It reforms one's aqidah, and we discussed that before. And it reforms one's set of values. And this is what we will discuss today. And starting next week, inshallah, we will be discussing how this surah reforms our thinking methods, how to think. Today we will start, or we will take inshallah, the set of values, how this surah is reforming our set of values. I want you to go to verse number 7 and number 8. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in verse number 7 and number 8 of Surah Al-Kahf, Inna ja'alna ma 'ala al-ardi zinatan laha لِنَبْلُوَهُمْ أَيُّهُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا وَإِنَّا لَجَاعِلُونَ مَا عَلَيْهَا صَعِيدًا جرزا. الله سبحانه وتعالى said, we have adorned the earth with attractive things so that we may test people to find out which of them do best. But we shall reduce all this to barren dust. From this, there are so many, these two verses, there are so many instructions here, or actually so many notifications that comes to us. Number one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that all the world pleasures are here for a reason, which is to test you. To test you. It's like when you give your child 10 pounds. It's to test him. It's not, you're not going to give him the 10 pounds to cover his own expenses. Still, you're covering his expenses. He's not going to pay his share in the rent. He's not going to pay his share in the food. But you give it to him to check how he will deal with this, with these 10 pounds. Is he wise enough or not? Mature enough or not? Is he going to spend it all on chewing gum and candy? Or is he going to spend half of it on chewing gum and candy, and the other half he will save? This is a better child. Or is he going to spend one third on candy, and one third to save, and one third to give to the poor? This is the best child. So you give it to monitor. Subhanallah, and for Allah is the highest example. Allah says here that he gave us all the world pleasures to monitor us, to test us. And then he said, وَإِنَّا لَجَاعِلُونَ مَا عَلَيْهَا صَعِيدًا جُرُزًا. And one day, everything will be reduced to just dry, coarse sand, or to barren dust. So all these world pleasures, actually, its real value is zero. No value. All these world pleasures, all the cars that you want to buy, all the houses that you want to buy, all the money that you want to save, all this on earth is actually of zero value. All these things that distract you in your salah are of zero value. All these things that may not, that may make you late for your salah, or for your acts of worship, or for doing good, are actually of zero value. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in a hadith in Sahih Muslim, said, "Inna dunya khadiratun hulwa, wallahu mustakhlifukum fiha, fayanzur kayfa ta'malun." The world is sweet and green, which means alluring. And surely Allah is making you to succeed each other, generations after generations, in it, in order to see how you act. So Allah wants to see how you act. Doesn't Allah know how we act? How we will act? Of course Allah knows how we will act. But it's for you to see how you act. Because if he punishes you without doing, because from his own knowledge, you will feel like it's unfair. So he wants you to see how you yourself will act before he rewards or punishes. And the Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّ أَكْثَرَ مَا أَخَافُ عَلَيْكُمْ مَا يُخْرِجُ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ مِنْ بَرَكَاتِ الْأَرْضِ قِيلَ وَمَا بَرَكَاتُ الْأَرْضِ قَالَ زَهْرَةُ الدُّنْيَا. He said, the thing that I'm afraid of most for your sake is the worldly blessings which Allah will bring forth to you. It was said, what are these blessings? The Prophet said, the pleasures of the world. So these world pleasures can be so dangerous. This doesn't mean that we should not enjoy them. No, we should enjoy them, but within the frame that Allah gave to us. Within the frame, and with modesty and with moderation. We should not exaggerate. And we should not let it keep us busy from the acts of worship. Exactly like when you check into a hotel room and you use the appliances, the TV, the coffee maker, the bed, the bathroom, but you know that tomorrow at 11 you are checking out. All these things do not really belong to you. That's exactly world pleasures. You are using them, but they don't really belong to you. Even your car, that you have its contract and its title and its papers and you think it belongs to you, is not really yours. Even your house, which is on your name. It's not really yours. Everything belongs to Allah. Deal with it like that, as if you checked into a hotel room. Deal with it with modesty, with moderation, and you are leaving again. It's again about ownership. Who is the real owner? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We spoke last time and we said that one of the two friends, one of them is a kafir, is very ungrateful to Allah, and he's arrogant because he's rich. And his Muslim friend is reminding him of what? أَكَفَرْتَ بِالَّذِي خَلَقَكَ. Are you committing kufr against the one who created you? So one of the important terms in our relationship with Allah is that Allah huwa al-khaliq. Allah is the creator. Here we want also to speak about another term, which is Allah huwa al-malik. Allah is the owner. He is the owner of everything. Come on, I'm also an owner. I own a car, I own a flat, I own my money which is in the bank. No, Allah is the real owner. And you are a supplementary owner. You know, I don't know if you have this here system here in the UK or not, but in Egypt, for example, you can have an account in the bank, and then you can issue a supplementary card to a relative, to a son, to a daughter, to a wife, to a spouse. And you give him this supplementary card, which means you are authorizing him or her to use your own money. You have that here. You can issue a supplementary card on your account or not. Okay, good. So this is exactly the case. Allah is the owner and you are the supplementary. He gave you the authorization to use some of his possessions temporarily. But the real owner is him. He can take it back, like the real owner of the account can cancel the supplementary card at any time. Allah can cancel this supplementary ownership of yours at any time. You have to deal with everything that you own like that. It's not really yours. It's not proper. It's improper to have your money in the bank and there are people starving. There are neighbors next to you who don't have money to buy food. So what do? Do I spend all my money? No, we didn't tell you to spend all your money and then you become like one of them. But Allah told you, you have to spend at least 2.5% of your cash savings that stayed with you for a whole year, unused. This means that when you took the kids to Greece in the summer, you need it. When you when the schools opened and you had to buy things for the children for the school, you didn't need it. Which means that's a really excess money that stayed with you for a whole year. How come you don't spend 2.5% and give your neighbor, whom you know, that he or she may be in need? And they cut off her benefits, for example. So these things are very important. How can you be Muslim and enjoy these blessings that Allah owns and He's testing you with, and you act stingily? So these things are very important. When every time you read, every Jumu'ah, when you read Surah Al-Kahf and you come across verse number 7 and number 8, remember this. Those who memorize verse number 7 and number 8, but they don't act upon it, it will come to witness against you on the Day of Judgment. What will happen to you if you double your zakat? Instead of paying 2.5%, pay 5%. Are you going to be poor? You still have 95%. You see, sometimes we act stingily. Go to verse number 16. Verse number 16. In verse number 16, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذِ اعْتَزَلْتُمُوهُمْ وَمَا يَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا اللَّهَ فَأُوُوا إِلَى الْكَهْفِ يَنْشُرْ لَكُمْ رَبُّكُمْ مِنْ رَحْمَتِهِ ويهيئ لكم من أمركم مرفقا. This is the story of the youth who slept in the cave. Actually, they left their people who were forcing them to leave Islam and worship the idols or worship whatever that they were worshiping. Here Allah tells them, now that you have left such people and what they worshiped instead of God, take refuge in the cave. God will shower His mercy on you and make you comfortable. وَيُهَيِّئْ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَمْرِكُمْ مِرْفَقًا. He will comfort you. Comfort you where? In the cave? Yes. How can I be comfortable in the cave? No chairs, no tables, no AC, no heating systems. Nothing. It's a cave. Some stones. But there are people who are millionaires, billionaires, who have a lot of, who live a lavish life. They live in mansions and palaces, and they throw themselves off the windows and balconies and they commit suicide, right? Because they are not comfortable. Comfort is not in the money. Comfort is in the heart. If Iman is in the heart, Allah comforts you. You want to enter Jannah here on earth? Have Iman in your heart. Read the Quran with reflection and tadabbur. This is the Jannah of Allah on earth. Here, the Quran is telling them, when you go to the cave seeking refuge from those kuffar who are trying to impose their faked religion or false religion on you, Allah will comfort you. Yes, people are comfortable when they have Iman in their heart. Doesn't matter how they live, because they will be content. There are very rich people that we can see them as very rich, and they see themselves very poor because they still want to be richer and more rich and acquire more money like others, because they keep looking at others who are more rich than them. So they will always stay poor. If you focus on the world pleasures, you will always be poor, feel poor. But if you focus on pleasing Allah, you will be content and self-sufficient. Go to verse number 34. See, all these verses are doing what to you? Are actually reforming your values, the set of values. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in verse number 34, وَكَانَ لَهُ ثَمَرٌ فَقَالَ لِصَاحِبِهِ وَهُوَ يُحَاوِرُهُ أَنَا أَكْثَرُ مِنْكَ مَالًا وَأَعَزُّ نَفَرًا. And so he had abundant fruit. One day while talking to his friend, he said, I have more wealth and a larger following than you. I have more followers. I have more children. I have a bigger family. I'm from a bigger clan than you. And I have more wealth than you. So he's arrogant because of what? Because of Allah's possessions that He gave to him to test him. So he's failing the test. He's failing the test. He's proud of himself instead of thanking Allah. He thinks these things belong to him individually, and he never believes that it's all from Allah, blessings from Allah to test him with. In verse number 38, the other friend, who is a Muslim, is also proud, but not proud of himself, proud of his God. He says, لَكِنَّهُ وَاللَّهُ رَبِّي وَلَا أُشْرِكُ بِرَبِّي أَحَدًا. But for me, He is God, my Lord, and I will never set up any partner with Him. So he's proud, but not proud of himself. Not proud of, not because he has a big ego, not because he has money. By the way, this man has money too, but less than the other. less than the other. Because who told us that he has money? It is verse number 34. He's telling him, I have more money than you. I have more wealth than you. And a larger following, which means that this man has also followers, has also a family, has also children, has. And he has also wealth, but less than the other. But this did not delude him. He's focusing on the biggest gift that Allah gave him, being a servant of Allah, being one of the ibadillahi as-salihin, one of the righteous servants of Allah. So these things should always, when we read it, reform our set of values. These are the real values. These are the things that you should be proud of. So number one, be proud of being Muslim. Second, let those who are close to Allah be close to you. Nah, yes, sometimes we choose our friends and our companions based on things like how they are dressed, how they speak, how they walk, they look cool or not. But actually, if you go to verse number 28, it tells you, وَاصْبِرْ نَفْسَكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَدَاتِ وَالْعَشِيِّ يُرِيدُونَ وَجْهَهُ وَلَا تَعْدُ عَيْنَاكَ عَنْهُمْ تُرِيدُ زِينَةَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَلَا تُطِعْ مَنْ أَغْفَلْنَا قَلْبَهُ عَنْ ذِكْرِنَا وَاتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ وَكَانَ أَمْرُهُ فُرُطًا. Content yourself with those who pray to their Lord morning and evening, seeking His approval, and do not let your eyes turn away from them out of desire for the attractions of this worldly life. Do not yield to those whose hearts we have made heedless of our Quran, those who follow their own low desires, those whose ways are unbridled. So here the Quran tells us, Surah Al-Kahf tells you how to choose your friends, how to choose your companions. And it says, wasbir nafsak, content yourself with those who pray to their Lord morning and evening. Which means, be patient. I know, yani, the Quran is as if it's telling you, the verse is telling you that I know that the other companions who are maybe are not very practicing Muslims, maybe sitting with them is more fun, but it's damaging. And it tells you here, be patient and sit and accompany those who make dhikr, who remember Allah. So how to choose your companion, how to choose your friend. The one whom when you see, he reminds you of Allah. Just by seeing him, reminds you by Allah. So content yourself with them.
Which verse was that?
Verse number 28. And it says, do not let your eyes turn away from them, from those companions that remind you with Allah. And do not follow those whose hearts are heedless of the Quran. Be careful. Yeah, of course we need to do da'wah to them, but not let them do da'wah to us. And you need to understand that the one who's not giving da'wah is receiving da'wah. Let's move to verse number 45. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
وَاضْرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا كَمَاءٍ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ كَمَاءٍ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ فَاخْتَلَطَ بِهِ نَبَاتُ الْأَرْضِ فَأَصْبَحَ هَشِيمًا فأصبح هشيما تذروه الرياح وكان الله على كل شيء مقتدرا.
Tell them what the life of this world is like. We sent water down from the skies and the earth's vegetation absorbs it. But soon the plants turn to dry stubble scattered about by the wind. God has power over everything. So Allah here tells us what the world pleasures are really are what?
It's like water that is sent from the sky. It takes what? Few seconds or a minute. And then it's absorbed by the vegetation, by the plants. And these plants become dry and stubble and scattered. Where are they? Scattered. So all the world pleasures are actually, they have a very short lifetime. Like the water that came down from the sky, absorbed by the plant, and the plant, and it will be lost. Everything that you have will be lost one day. When you die, you leave it behind you. You're not going to take it with you. And it can be lost like that. If Allah tests you and you fail the test, it can be lost, it can be taken from you. So don't stick to the world pleasures like that. Don't stick to it like that. You prove your iman by spending for the sake of Allah, by covering the expenses of the needy. There are people who are thrown in the street. They don't have a place to stay. There are women, there are mothers, single mothers, divorcees in our community, and they suffer and they struggle. How can we be Muslim if we don't help? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in verse number 46, go to verse number 46.
المال والبنون زينة الحياة الدنيا والباقيات الصالحات خير عند ربك ثوابا وخير أملا.
Wealth and children are the attractions of this worldly life, but lasting goods, works, but lasting good work have a better reward with your Lord and give better grounds for hope. So the reason why we act in a stingy way sometimes and we don't give our zakah, we don't sacrifice for the sake of Allah, we don't help others, is because of those two things. Wealth and children. I want to keep everything for my children, thinking that this will be better. You know, if there are some worms with some food that you have, the worms will eat the food. That's exactly what you do when you don't spend your zakah. The zakah acts as a worm. I'm sorry, the zakah money that you don't spend becomes haram money. And you add the haram to the halal to increase the halal. So what happens is the haram eats the halal. Those who don't spend for the sake of Allah, those who don't spend their obligatory charity, the zakah money, and think that they will be increasing their wealth, they are actually destroying their wealth. And this normally happens because of al-malu wal-banun, wealth and children. Sometimes our children make us stingy. Not their fault, it's our fault. We think that if we give them the halal to eat up, this is good for them. So we have to be very careful with that. I want you now to imagine that. You were told, choose between. There is, as if I have two cups, one made of gold. I'm not going to drink in the gold one, of course, but it's a wealth. If I own it, it's a wealth. Wealth. And one made of plastic that doesn't even, worth 1p. Nothing. And someone tells you, choose between them. Either you own the plastic cup so that you can use. If you want to drink, you can use it to drink. Or you hold the gold one for just 1 second and leave it back. Which one do you choose? To own the plastic or to hold the gold one for 1 second? Of course, I'll take the plastic because I'm going to own it. If someone chooses to just hold the gold for 1 second, this is what? Huh? Yeah, but this is what? Is this wise? Very unwise. Very stupid actually. Very stupid decision. Good. What if the opposite? Someone tells you, choose. Do you want to own the gold? Own the gold. Which makes you a very rich person. Because it's a wealth. Or hold the plastic cup for one moment. Which one do you choose? To own the gold. What if one chose the opposite? To hold the plastic for one moment and leave it. This would be what? An idiot. Very clear. This is a very idiotic decision. Believe me, everyone who chooses the world pleasures that are temporarily like plastic, temporarily, and sacrifices owning the gold, which are the pleasures of the hereafter, is doing a very idiotic decision. This is exactly the example of world pleasures. All the world pleasures are like a plastic cup. And they are temporary. So those who choose to enjoy the world pleasures, who are like a plastic cup, temporarily, for moments, this life is like moments, and sacrifice the everlasting gold, the everlasting pleasures of the hereafter, are actually very stupid. Remember these things when you read these verses every Friday, because through this you can be saved from a lot of fitna, the fitna of money, of wealth. That's why this surah saves from the fitna of the Dajjal, because the Dajjal will come with the fitna of in religion. So when you see the youth who slept in the cave sacrificing the world pleasures for their iman, this, when you read this with understanding and reflection every week, it will save you from the fitna of religion of the Dajjal. The Dajjal also comes with the fitna of wealth. He will be so wealthy. This will save you. When you understand these values, when you have them in your heart. Since we have time, alhamdulillah, I want now to move to the third axis, which is reforming the methods of thinking. One of the problems of Muslims is that we generalize a lot. Most of the time we are generalizing. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us not to generalize. And also, one of the problems of Muslims is that they speak about things that they have no knowledge about. Some people may have no knowledge about stock market, but they see people talking about and discussing stock market, so they just participate in the discussion just to look good. That's not right. All these things are mentioned here. Also, some people speak without evidence. They just tell you something without any evidence. All these things are mentioned in the surah. Some people don't know how to prioritize, how to choose. All these things we will speak about it inshallah in details during the coming weeks inshallah. We will start now with one of these things. One of them is objective thinking. Go to verse number 4 and number 5. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is criticizing the Christians here. For doing what? وَيُنذِرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا اتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ وَلَدًا مَا لَهُمْ بِهِ مِنْ عِلْمٍ وَلَا لِآبَائِهِمْ
كبرت كلمة تخرج من أفواههم إن يقولون إلا كذبا.
It warns those, this book warns those people who assert for God that God has an offspring, that he has a son. And then the Quran says what? They have no knowledge about this, nor did their forefathers had any knowledge about it. It's a monstrous assertion that comes out of their mouths. What they say is nothing but lies. What is their problem? They spoke about something without knowledge. They didn't have knowledge about it. Neither them nor their forefathers. So this is the issue. Here you find that the Quran is saying, had they had knowledge, they can do that. But they don't have knowledge about it. So here the Quran is like warning you as a Muslim. Not just telling you stories about other people. It's warning you from falling in the same mistake by not thinking objectively and speak about things that you don't have knowledge about it. You find people discussing stock market, you don't understand what stock market is, please shut your mouth. If you discuss it just to look good, maybe someone there among them looks at you, he sees you like wearing a suit and a tie. He thinks that you really you look knowledgeable about that, and you spoke about the stock of Microsoft. So he goes next day and he puts all his wealth in Microsoft stock because you spoke highly about that stock without no knowledge, and he loses all his money. Just don't talk. Actually, Islam even goes further than that. Go to verse number 15. Amazing verse. Amazing verse. It says, speaking about those who are speaking here are the youth who slept in the cave, who sought refuge from the kuffar in the cave, saying, هَؤُلَاءِ قَوْمُنَا اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِهِ إِلَهَا آلِهَا هَؤُلَاءِ قَوْمُنَا اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِهِ آلِهَا لَوْلَا يَأْتُونَ عَلَيْهِم بِسُلْطَانٍ بَيِّنٍ فَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنِ افْتَرَى عَلَى اللَّهِ كَذِبًا. These people of ours have taken gods other than Allah, others than Him. What is their mistake? Why do they not produce clear evidence about them? If they just have evidence, which means what? If there is evidence on other God besides Allah, we will worship Him. This is the only religion that tells you to leave it if you find evidence. If you find evidence that other religion, that any other religion is the right one, leave. And this is what the Quran is telling you. Also, in Surah Al-Zukhruf, verse number 81, you don't have to move to the Surah. I will tell you the verse so that you don't miss the you don't miss the order. The Prophet ﷺ was entering into a debate against the Christians of Najran. So Allah told him to start his debate by saying what? قُلْ إِن كَانَ لِلرَّحْمَانِ وَلَدٌ فَأَنَا أَوَّلُ الْعَابِدِينَ. Say, O Muhammad, say, if the Lord of Mercy, Ar-Rahman, had offspring, I would be the first to worship them or him. Yani if Allah really had a son, I would worship him. I'll be the first one to worship him. The Quran tells us, if Allah really has a son, which means we are truth seekers. We are seeking the truth. The issue is Allah will never have a son. But when you start by speaking like that, you are opening the other people's mind and hearts that you are ready to change if you find evidence. So you are neutralizing them. And they also start to take the same position that they also are ready to change, become ready to change if they find evidence. And then you show them the evidence. See, this is the objective thinking. That's why I see that the brothers and sisters who are approached by missionaries And they start when they debate with missionaries by proving to them that the Bible is corrupt, are wrong. That's wrong. That's a wrong approach. When I'm approached by missionaries, and it happened to me several times, I tell them, look, my religion tells me that if I find evidence in anything else, I'll go and embrace it. Any religion, if I find evidence. And I want you to tell me, are you ready like me? Are you open-minded like me to change also if I show you the truth? They will say what? Yes, because you're putting them against the wall. So yes, of course. Okay, good. I want you to follow your Bible. Instead of telling them the Bible is corrupt, I want you to follow your own book. Tell me, is God the greatest according to Christianity? Is God the greatest in the universe? Is he the greatest thing? They will tell you what? Definitely yes. Good. Can God do everything? Inna Allah ala kulli shay'in qadir. Like in the Quran, I tell them, in the Quran tells me, God can indeed do everything. Is it the same in Christianity? They will tell you definitely yes. The third, does God know everything? Is God the knower of all? Like in the Quran, Inna Allah bi kulli shay'in alim. Allah knows everything. They will tell you definitely yes. That's nice. That's a lot of commonalities. Is Jesus God? They will tell you yes. Tell them, but the Bible has a verse that says, Jesus is saying, the Father is greater than I. So Jesus is saying that he's not the greatest. How can he be God? Didn't he just say that God is the greatest? No, they said God is the greatest. And now Jesus is saying that he's not the greatest. The Father is greater than him. So how can he be God? They will be speechless. Second, Jesus said also, and you can Google these verses and get the numbers of the, because I don't remember the exact numbers and the references. Jesus also said, out of my own self I can do nothing, which means without the help of God I can't do anything. So this goes against that God can do everything, because you said Jesus is God and he is telling that he cannot do anything without, out of his own self. How can he be God? Or is Jesus lying? Jesus doesn't lie, neither according to Islam or Christianity. He will not lie. So he is not a God here. He is not, so not a God, because he's not the greatest. Well, about knowledge, Jesus said, about this day or this hour, no one has knowledge. Not the angels or the Son, the Father alone knows, which means only the Father knows when is the day of judgment. But Jesus doesn't know. So Jesus doesn't know everything. That's exactly what the Quran says. The Quran says, جَعَلُوا اللَّهَ ثَالِثُ ثَلَاثَ. They made Allah one out of three. Because they have the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Father is God, according to Christianity. And the Son is God, according to Christianity. And the Holy Spirit is God, according to Christianity. This is called the personification of God. For them, God is three different persons. Every one of them is God, and all of them are one God. So as not to sound polytheistic. You will not understand this. And it's impossible to understand. According to Saint Victor's Madhab, Saint Victor's school of thought of the 12th century, that the Trinity is something that you cannot understand. You just have to take it as it is. So the objective thinking here is, instead of attacking their book, no, I tell them, I show them from their own book that their teachings and the doctrine is not complying with their own book. Better than attacking the book and telling them it's corrupt. Later, in a later stage, you can show them the corruptions. It's okay. But don't start with that. This is what they call objective thinking. Every time you talk, you should know what is your goal and see what are you, what the, your words getting you to. Are they leading you to your goal or not before you speak? Sometimes we just speak and then we find the results. No, you should know the end result that you want and then you speak. There is also among the generalization problem, which is against objective thinking. If you ask Muslims about Jews, you have to be clear with this. Most Muslims would tell you, no, Jews are people who do not keep their promises and agreements. But this is totally against the Quran. Can you imagine this? The Quran tells us in Surah Al-Baqarah, verse number 100, أَوَكُلَّمَا عَاهَدُوا عَهْدًا نَبَذَهُ فَرِيقٌ مِّنْهُمْ. Isn't it true that every time they make a covenant or an agreement or a pledge, a group of them throw it away? It doesn't tell you all of them. See here, the Quran is very objective. The Quran tells you not to generalize. Not to generalize. But we like to generalize a lot. We say Jews are like that. Bengalis are like this. Pakistanis are like that. All Arabs are so. All white people are so. All black people are so. This is totally against the Quran, because the Quran tells us laysu sawaa, verse number 113 in Ali Imran. It says they are not all the same. Teaching you to think objectively and not generalize. Don't generalize. See if we have something short to say today. One of the things actually that I want you to think about is boycotting Starbucks. Who's boycotting Starbucks? Good. Because the Starbucks coffee is what? The blood of the Palestinians, right? Find me the evidence. I'm not telling you not to boycott Starbucks. I'm coming next week and I want you to find me the evidence on that Starbucks helps Israel. If you find that, I will boycott Starbucks with you. I'll be leading a campaign to boycott Starbucks. But if you don't find evidence, then you are committing oppression against Starbucks and the Starbucks owners. And I'm not gonna elaborate on this, but let this be your homework this week and see if you have an evidence that Starbucks helps Israel or not. And the evidence should be what? Credible. A credible evidence, not people who forged something on the internet. But if not, then you have to understand that sometimes these things are like drugs. Drugs. You boycott Starbucks and you're comfortable like that, thinking that you are helping the Palestinian cause like that, while actually it can be all fake, just something to comfort you with. I'm not telling you not to boycott Starbucks. I'm not telling you to go and buy Starbucks. I'm telling you that next week I want to find evidence with you. This is why we need the Quran. To change ourselves and change our minds and change our traditions and change. We sometimes just follow. Someone starts by throwing something and it rolls. We receive emails and we open it and we cry and we forward them, and sometimes they are nonsense. Sometimes these emails are nonsense. Someone once sent me an email saying, wow, the numeric miracle of the Quran. And I opened. It says, the word day is mentioned equal to the word night. Wow, what a miracle. And then I thought to myself, before I push forward, what's the miracle in this? I can write a book tomorrow and mention the word day equal to the number of the word night. What's the miracle in this? So see, sometimes our passion for Islam makes us do things without thinking. As Muslims, we should be very objective. We should always think objectively. One of the things is, sometimes we feel danger from the other people cultures. Some cultures are not a danger to Islam at all. Actually, our forefathers succeeded and became the leaders of civilization during the golden ages because they did not look like that to other people cultures. Actually, they looked at them, they chose what's good in them, and they built on it. They didn't look like everything which is non-Islamic is wrong. Who said so? Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is our what? Example, our role model. Good. He was an immigrant. He was an immigrant. I'm an immigrant, by the way. I wasn't born here, so I'm an immigrant. He's my example. And many of us are immigrants or sons of immigrants. He immigrated to Medina, and then what did he do? Yeah, but he integrated. He integrated himself to the extent, listen to this, to the extent that he changed some aspects of his Meccan culture in order to suit the culture of the new country, Medina, but without compromising his religion. Here is the subtle difference. When it comes to the religion, my religion is my flesh and my blood. I'm not gonna change it, I'm not gonna compromise it. Other things, I can compromise it. Evidence on this. You see, everything that you hear from someone, say, what's your evidence? Don't let anyone play with your mind. When Lady Aisha was coming back from the wedding, the Prophet ﷺ asked her, did you have fun? She said, yeah, we had fun. He said, what did you sing? He said, no, we didn't sing. He said, how come you don't sing in a wedding? You Meccans are not in Mecca anymore. You are here in Medina, and the people of Medina, the Ansar, love singing. Why didn't you sing for them? Ataynakum, ataynakum. And he suggested a song that could have been sung in a wedding. Meccans don't like singing. He said, you're not in Mecca anymore. Change your culture in a way that suits other people's culture, but without compromising your religion. When it comes to my religion, when it comes to etiquettes of my religion, etiquettes of interaction between men and women, when it comes to religion, I'm not gonna compromise. But other things can be compromised. There's no problem. This is the issue. Sometimes we hold the traditions and customs and culture as important as religion, which is not true. Not true. Today, I laughed a lot before coming when I opened one of the hashtags on Twitter. It's about women driving in Saudi Arabia. You feel like you went to another planet. They have their problems that are peculiar, actually. They don't exist in any other country. They are still in 2014 discussing women should drive or not. They say, no, they shouldn't drive. Yeah, but the law is not allowing them to drive. But the law is allowing them to stay with for hours with the drivers who haven't seen their wives for 5 years. Is this the halal? Is this okay, but women driving and is haram? What's that? So this is the issue. And they tell, we didn't say haram, but that is actually, it is culture. What culture is this? What's in the culture here? Who said that this is good? It's the first question in every lecture that comes from non-Muslims, either the first or the second question after terrorism. Why Islam is not allowing women to drive? Because people look at Saudi Arabia think that this is the example. See here, so the problem is, sometimes mixing culture with religion harms Islam and harms the da'wah. We need to understand these things. Okay? So we have to ascertain. Next week, inshallah, we will talk about ascertaining. And here, we will discuss a very important incident that happened, which is the incident of the slander. Hadithat al-ifk. The slander of Lady Aisha. Some hypocrites slandered Lady Aisha.
And they accused her of committing zina, committing adultery with one of the companions. Can you imagine this?
And the problem is some Sahaba, some companions who did not think objectively, they just repeated what they heard. We will talk about this next week, inshallah. Now I have 5 minutes for questions. So if anyone has any questions, I can, inshallah, address it, inshallah. So, who's first? Who wants to ask a question? Ladies or brothers? No one? Yes.
She mentioned her brother comes from Aisha singing. Could you give us the narration of the hadith?
I have to check the hadith for you, but it's an authentic hadith. Yeah, if you just Google it, say Ataynakum, Ataynakum, for example, this is a song, you will get the whole hadith.
But did he say openly or he said Nishidi or how would the
Ibarat? I can get you the
difference
between Al-Ghina in or singing in Islam means singing. Not necessarily associated with music. And even if when it comes to music, we can also discuss this, by the way. And there is also difference of opinions on it, by the way. Okay? So here the Prophet was asking her, what did you sing? Whether it's nasheed or what's the difference between nasheed and ughniyah? What's the difference? Is it just the music or something else?
If it is desire, it can be ughniyah.
No, these are the names that we chose for them. Actually, at the time of the Prophet, it was neither called singing or it was called al-hida'. Al-hida'. So, and it is mentioned in the seerah that كان الحادي يصحب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في الأسفار. ولما كان اسمه أنجش ولما كان يغني, he used to say, يعني voice very good, so the Prophet used to tell him, رفقا بالقوارير يا أنجش. It's called الحادي, الحداء. So it's a matter here of names, changing names. Okay? Let's check the hadith and get you, inshallah, the exact words of the hadith. Okay? Okay? That's nice also. About the type of singing itself. If something that arouses the desires and stuff like that should not be in public, but can be heard if it's not nasty with the husband and the wife. They can hear it. They can listen to it. Okay? But if it's not nasty words, if it's not bad words, you understand? But in public, what the Prophet actually suggested is a normal song that can be sang in a wedding in public. Okay, there was a sister who raised her hand here. Yes. It's not Islam, it is. قُلْ إِنْ كَانَ لِلْرَّحْمَانِ وَلَدٌ فَأَنَا أَوَّلُ الْعَابِدِينَ. Say, if Ar-Rahman has a son, I'll be the first one to worship him. You want the reference of this verse? Zukhruf 81. Of course, if someone worships someone as a son of God, he's leaving the religion, actually. Okay? But the verse doesn't say leave the religion. It says, I'll be the first one to worship him, which is leaving the religion of Islam. In Islam, we only worship Allah. Allah doesn't have a son. Okay? Also, in Surah Al-Kahf, it is verse number 15. Which is, those are our people, they worshipped other gods besides Allah. What if they just produce evidence? Which means, if they produce evidence, then they are right. You see, how are the children's be the test as stated in Surah Al-Kahf? What do you mean? How are the children's be the test? Ah, okay. المال والبنون زينة الحياة الدنيا والبنون. It means that these men and children and wealth are the world pleasures. And sometimes, for example, I want to go to pray Isha in the mosque. Then I come back from work and I see the children playing and I enjoy so much watching them playing. So I say to myself, if I go to the mosque and come back, probably they will be asleep. So I stay and I don't pray in the mosque. For example, as a man. Here, the children made me stingy, made me back off from doing something, an act of worship. So sometimes we are stingy, we don't give our zakah because we want to increase our wealth, because we want good future for the children, and we pay for their education or whatever. Here the children can be a test for you. trying to read. Please confirm, should a woman not have a shower whilst on their periods? Why not? Of course you have to take a shower, but after the period, when you make sure that the period is over, you have to take a shower in order to be able to pray and touch the Quran and everything. But of course you can have a shower. Women can have a period for a week. Yeah, have a shower every day, no problem. Someone says not allowed to wash until finished menstruation. I never ever heard that opinion before. During this time of Christmas period in a workplace, colleagues are organizing small afternoon parties. It seems to be rude to refuse to gather with them each time. So how can we conciliate that with our religion and say yes, especially if there might be alcohol? Now there is this alcohol, you have a flu, you don't go, you're sensitive to alcohol. Your religion doesn't allow you to stay, by the way, if there's alcohol. So they have to understand that. So you are understanding their feelings, but they shouldn't understand your feelings? Excuse me. If there is alcohol, of course you don't participate. You don't participate. But if there is no alcohol, here comes the etiquettes of interaction between men and women. If the etiquettes of interaction are kept, are okay, participate. But if there's no etiquettes of interaction, I don't mean etiquettes, I mean separators, but I mean there are etiquettes of interaction. There will be dancing and stuff like that. Of course, this is not a place where I'll be attending still. So here, I cannot judge until I know exactly what will happen. So you check if what's happening is halal or haram. That's it. And do you greet people for Christmas? No, you just say like season's greetings, but you don't have Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas, actually, here there's a difference of opinions. There's the opinion that say as long as you are just greeting them for their Eid, like they greet you for their Eid, you can do so. I'm actually, when it comes to their Eids, I have to understand what kind of Eid is it. Easter is totally against our Aqidah. Totally, because we do not believe that Jesus died for 3 days and then he was resurrected back. So I cannot say happy Easter or whatever. Okay? But I can say like happy new year, season's greetings, but I'm not gonna acknowledge something that goes against my aqidah like Easter. Christmas is what? Is Jesus was born? He was born. Actually, in Islam, we do not celebrate Mulid of the Prophet ﷺ or Christmas or the Mulid or the birthday of Prophet Moses or anyone. By the way, we have two Eids in Islam, the Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha. But here, some scholars said, because Allah told us to be fair and just with them, those who greet you in your Eid, greet them, but avoid saying like this is the greeting of your Eid. You can say like season's greetings, but you don't have to say Merry Christmas, Happy Easter. Avoid that. Say season's greetings. Okay? I wish this year is a good year for you. Say all the other words that can like make up for this. Okay?
Internal evidence is, if you're speaking to an atheist, for example, and they ask you, what is your evidence that God is one and He is Allah?
Now it's too late to start this discussion. When an atheist asks you, how do you prove that there is a God and how do you prove that He is one? This is a long discussion, but I can actually refer you to a very good documentary that we have called, you know, in Bridges Foundation, we make documentaries about Islam. One of them is called Islam in Brief. If you write, actually it's a channel on YouTube called Islami Brief. So when you type www.youtube.com/islaminbrief, it will take you to a channel where this documentary is in 31 languages. It is actually divided into 10 chapters. One of the chapters is, does God exist? It has very good arguments, logical arguments that prove that there is a God, definitely. Okay, so go to this and watch it, inshallah. It's too late to discuss it now, it takes a long time. Yes?
Isa alayhi salam born in summer?
Was he born? I don't know if he was born in the Christmas or not. Probably not. I don't know. Of course, I don't know, in summer, in winter. The issue is, people who greet you in your Eid, they have a Eid now. And this Eid is not totally against your Aqidah, because we believe that Jesus was born. Okay, it doesn't say son of God or anything. He's not son of God or at all. So you can hear, for example, take it as a chance to speak about Islam as well. And you tell them, oh, so these days are the Christmas, right? Well, I want to greet you for the season and for the new year. And you need to understand that we also believe in Jesus. But for us, Jesus is not a son of God, that's true, but we also respect him so much because he is one of the best five people who ever walked the face of the earth. He's for us a prophet of Islam. Do you find this interesting? Yeah, you want to read something, then you give him something like Jesus the prophet of Islam, it's a book. So you can use these things to do da'wah even, by the way, by talking about Jesus and his mother, and that we have a whole chapter of the Quran named after the mother of Jesus. We don't have a chapter named after the mother of Prophet Muhammad. Like that. So you take it as a chance to give da'wah. But here the scholar said, avoid, you know, like saying speaking like it's particularly for Christmas or Easter or so on. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, actually, you want to prove that the 24th of December is not the day where Jesus was born. No problem. There's no problem with that. The issue is, I'm not agreeing with their religion, by the way. I'm not agreeing on many things that they do. So it's not my problem that they are celebrating the birth of Jesus in a wrong day. This is not the main problem in their religion, by the way. The main problem is that they are worshipping him, actually. So it's not a point of discussion. Yani, it's not the only thing which is wrong in their religion. Yani, they have a lot of wrong things, but we have to coexist with each other. Those people who greet you in your Eid, is it fair to not greet them? So the scholar said, here in this case, you can greet them, but avoid saying Merry Christmas or Happy Easter or stuff like that. I'm talking about people who greet you in your Eid, but there are some of them who don't greet you in your Eid. Khalas, don't greet. Fine. This is the issue. But those who come to you and say, Happy Eid, are you having an event in the mosque? And they come to the mosque and stuff like that. Those people in their own Eid, it's improper not to show them any, you know, any amicability. It's impossible. Impossible. So here, the scholar said, avoid speaking about the Eid itself and just say season greeting. And speak about anything. No problem. Yeah, it's not a big issue here, by the way. So, Jazakumullah khairan, barakallahu feekum. Next week, inshallah, is a very important lecture, mainly about spreading rumors, about the slander of Lady Aisha, about these things. So invite your friends, and Jazakumullah khairan.